William Morrow and Harper Audio present The Night Visitors, a novel by Carol Goodman, performed by Jane Oppenheimer. To the people of family, the true kindly ones. A name can change one's core identity. The Furies thus became the kindly ones. Athena ending senseless cruelty. A name can change one's core identity. Benevolence diverts from treachery, and shining like her crown, pure goodness wins. A name can change one's core identity. The Furies thus became the kindly ones. Lee Slonimsky. Chapter 1. Alice. Oren falls asleep at last on the third bus. He's been fighting it since Newburgh. Eyelids heavy as wet laundry, pried up again and again by sheer stubbornness. Finally, I think when he nods off. If I have to answer one more of his questions, I might lose it. Where are we going? He asked on the first bus. Someplace safe, I answered. He stared at me, even in the darkened bus, his eyes shining with too much smart for his age, and then looked away as if embarrassed for me. An hour later, he'd asked, as if there hadn't been miles of highway in between. Where is it safe? There are places, I'd begun, as if telling him a bedtime story. But then I'd had to rack my brain for what came next. All I could picture were candy houses and chicken-legged huts that hid witches. Those weren't the stories he liked best anyway. He preferred the book of myths from the library. It's still in his pack, racking up finds with every mile. About heroes who wrestle lions and behead snake-haired monsters. There are places, I began again, trying to remember something from the book. Remember when Orestes flees the Furies and he goes to some temple so the Furies can't hurt him there? It was the temple of Apollo at Delphi, Oren said, and it's called a sanctuary. No one likes a smarty pants, I countered. Since he found that mythology book, he likes to show off how well he's learned all those Greek names. He'd liked Orestes right away because their names were alike. I'd tried to read around the parts that weren't really for kids, but he always knew if I skipped over something. And later, I saw him reading the story to himself, staring at the picture of the Furies with their snake hair and bat wings. At the next bus stop, he found the flyer for the hotline. It was called Sanctuary, as if Oren saying the word had made it appear. I gave him a handful of change to buy a candy bar while I made the call. I didn't want him to hear the story I'd have to tell. But even with him across the waiting room, standing at the snacks counter, his shoulders hunched under the weight of his Star Wars backpack, he looked like he was listening. The woman who answered the phone started to ask about my feelings, but I cut to the chase and told her that I'd left my husband and taken my son with me. He hit me, I said, and he told me he'd kill me if I tried to leave. I have no place to go. My voice had stuttered to a choked end. Across the waiting room, Oren had turned to look at me as if he'd heard me. But that was impossible. He was too far away. The woman's voice on the phone was telling me about a shelter in Kingston. Oren was walking across the waiting room. When he reached me, he said, "It can't be a place anyone knows about." I rolled my eyes at him like I didn't know that. But I repeated his words into the phone anyway, trying to sound firm. The woman on the other end didn't say anything for a moment. And looking into Oren's eyes, I was suddenly more afraid than I'd been since we left. "I understand," the woman said at last, slowly, as if she were speaking to someone who might not understand. I recognized the social worker's explaining voice and felt a prickle of anger that surprised me. I'd thought that I was past caring what a bunch of morally sanctimonious social workers thought about me. We can arrange for a safe house, one no one will know about, but you might have to stay tonight in the shelter. Oren shook his head as if he could hear what the woman said, or as if he already knew I'd messed up. It has to be tonight, I said. Again, the woman paused. In the background, a cat meowed and a kettle whistled. I pictured a comfortable, warm room, framed pictures on the walls, throw pillows on a couch, lamplight, and was suddenly swamped by so much anger I grew dizzy. Oren reached out a hand to steady me. The woman said something, but I missed it. There was a roaring in my ears. Give me the number there, she was saying. I'll make a call and call you right back. I read her the number on the payphone and then hung up. Oren handed me a cup of hot coffee and a donut. How had he gotten all that for a handful of change? Does he have money of his own he hasn't told me about? I slumped against the wall to wait, and Oren leaned next to me. It will be all right, I told him. These places, they have a system. He nodded, jaw clenched. I touched his cheek and he flinched. I looked around to see if anyone had noticed, but the only other occupants of the station were a texting college student, the old woman behind the snacks counter, and a drunk passed out on a bench. When the phone rang, I nearly jumped out of my skin. I picked up the phone before it rang again. For a second, all I heard was breathing, and I had the horrible, crazy thought that it was him. But then the woman spoke in a breathless rush, as if she'd run somewhere fast. Can you get the next bus for Kingston? I told you, no shelter, I began, but the woman cut me off. At Kingston, you'll get a bus to Delphi. Someone will meet you there, someone you can trust. Her name's Mattie. She's in her 50s, has short silvery hair, and she'll probably be wearing something purple. She'll take you to a safe house, a place no one knows about but us. I looked down at Oren, and he nodded. Okay, I said. We'll be there on the next bus. I hung up and knelt down to tell Oren where we were going, but he was already handing something to me. 2 tickets for the next bus for Kingston and 2 for Delphi, New York. Look, he said, the town's got the same name as the place in the book. That was 2 hours and 2 buses ago. The last bus has taken us through steadily falling snow into mountains that loom on either side of the road. Oren had watched the swirling snow as if it were speaking to him, as if he were the one leading us there. It's just a coincidence, I tell myself, about the name. Lots of these little upstate towns have names like that. Athens, Utica, Troy. Names that make you think of palm trees and marble, not crappy little crossroads with 1 7-Eleven and a tattoo parlor. I was relieved when Oren fell asleep. Not just because I was tired of his questions, but because I was afraid of what I might ask him. How did you know where we were going? And how the hell did you get those tickets? And what I might do to get the answer out of him. Chapter 2. Mattie. I wake up to the sound of a train whistle blowing. Such a lonesome sound, my mother used to say. I've never thought so. To me, it always sounded like the siren call of faraway places. I used to lie in bed imagining where those tracks led. Out of these mountains, along the river, down to the city. Someday I'd answer that call and leave this place. It takes me a moment to realize that it's my phone ringing that has woken me. And then another few moments to realize that I'm not that girl plotting her escape. I'm a woman on the wrong side of 50, back where she started, with no way out but one. The phone's plugged in on my nightstand. One of my young college interns showed me how to set it so only certain people can get through. But what if someone who needs me has lost their phone and is calling from a phone booth? I asked. She blinked at me like I was a relic of the last century and asked, "Do they even have those anymore?" You ought to get out more, Doreen always tells me. Come down to the city with me. It must be Doreen on the phone. She's the only one on the list of favorites aside from Sanctuary's number that I'd programmed into the phone. When the college girl saw that puny list, she hadn't been able to hide the pity in her eyes. I reach for the phone, past pill bottles, paperbacks, and teacups, all my strategies to coax sleep, and manage to knock it over for my pains. I hear Dulcie stir, the vibration of the impact waking her. "It's okay, girl," I croon, even though she can't hear me. "It's just Doreen riled up about something." I swing my legs around onto the floor, the floorboards cold on my bare feet, and lean down to find the phone. The screen is lit up with Doreen's face. The college intern showed me how to do that too, taking a picture from Doreen's Facebook page of her protesting at the Women's March in January. Her mouth is open mid-shout, which is kind of a joke because Doreen almost never shouts. She has the calmest voice of anyone I know. She could talk anyone down, the volunteers say. That's why she always takes the hotline for the midnight to 6 a.m. shift, those hours when the worst things happen. Men stumble home drunk from bars and women lock their guns away. Teenagers overdose, and girls find themselves out on the road without a safe ride home, or take the wrong one. Which one of those terrible things has happened to make Doreen call me in the middle of the night? I draw my finger across the screen to answer. "Hi, Doreen." "Oh, thank God, Mattie," she says in a breathless rush as if she'd been running. Doreen always sounds like that. She ran away from her abusive ex 17 years ago after he slammed her son's head up against the dining room wall. And sometimes I think she's still running. "I thought you'd let your phone die again." "No, I just knocked it over. What is it, a bad call?" Sometimes Doreen will call me because she's upset by a call. I don't mind. No one should have to sit alone in the night with the things we have to hear. "A domestic violence case. Left home," she says, and my heart sinks. I let out a sigh and feel a pressure against my leg. Dulcie has picked up on my distress and come over to lean against me. "With a child?" I ask, hoping the answer is no. "A 10-year-old boy. She was in the Newburgh bus station. I offered the Kingston shelter, but she said no. She said it had to be a place no one could find her." "Oh," I say, reaching down to stroke Dulcie's soft head. "I checked availability at St. Albans, and Sister Martine said they could take her," Doreen says. "But someone needs to pick her up at the bus station and take her there." The sisters at St. Albans are one of our best links on the Domestic Violence Underground Railroad. Their convent is on the river, gated, and guarded by a mother superior who would face down a dozen angry husbands come searching for their wayward women. It's a chilly place to wash up after you've left your home in the night, though. The nuns in their long black habits, the bare cells, the crucifixes on the walls. I think of that 10-year-old boy, of what he'll feel like in that cold, gray place. "I could call Frank," she says. I hear the hesitation in her voice. Has the woman told her something that makes Doreen think it might not be a good idea to call our local chief of police? Or has she just sensed that there might be some reason to keep the law out of it for now? Or maybe she's just uneasy saying Frank's name to me. Doreen has a theory that Frank Barnes has a crush on me. I've tried to tell her how wrong she is about that, but Doreen doesn't buy it. "I'll pick them up and take them," I say, already getting up and reaching for the light switch. The weight against my leg slides away as the light floods the room. Doreen is saying something to me, something about the woman that had troubled her or something that the woman had reminded her of, but I don't catch it. I'm staring at the dog bed at the foot of the bed. I'd moved it there a couple of weeks ago because I kept tripping over Dulcie on my way to the bathroom. She's lying there now, fast asleep. There's no time to dwell on the phantom pressure on my leg. Diabetic nerve pain. Menopausal hot flash. The early onset Alzheimer's that felled my mother by my age. More important, the woman and the boy will be arriving at the bus station in an hour. It's only a 15-minute drive from the house, but that's assuming the car starts and there's no ice to scrape off the windows, and the roads are plowed. While I'm pulling on leggings and jeans, thermal top and sweater, I go to the window to look out. The view of my backyard is a gray and white blur of ominous lumps and dark encroaching forest. I can't tell if the snow in the yard is fresh or if the gray in the air is fog or falling snow. There's no back porch light to catch the falling flakes. "You should fix that," I hear my mother's voice saying. "You're letting the place go to seed." "You should mind your own business," I tell her right back. She's been dead for 34 years.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.